We've had three teams in the last month that came in tried to poach our rhino.
If you remove a million poachers now, there's a million more that will take over.
At the moment, nobody wants to farm with rhino. Everybody wants to sell.
They're the ones that are being slaughtered at two a day.
We even endanger our own lives because they will shoot us. So.
There's a war out there, with an enemy more advanced and sophisticated than any of its intended victims, forces, or strategies. And yet, we find a tiny army of individuals and animals somehow hidden and protected under a greater covering, a covering so effective that even the most sophisticated of enemies cannot penetrate it. What is that covering? Who are these unseen warriors? And why do they have hope of victory against such a terrible and offensive force? Why do they bother to fight at all? And why are the weapons of their warfare so different, unconventional, and yet powerfully effective to the tearing down of strongholds?
Today with Douwlina and the rest of the rhino, and today we will be dehorning the rhino to protect them from the poachers. Poaching has obviously gotten so severe that we have to take more extreme measures to keep them safe. We've got a crew coming. We're going to be working probably all day long, but it will have veterinary services, we'll have a helicopter, we'll have everything she needs, all Douwlina and the rest of the rhino, to make sure that she has the safest removal possible.
Okay, so I'm basically here to monitor the whole process.
I'm Kara and I'm from Cape Town and I'm studying doing my honours in financial analysis at UCT. And I'm doing the financial impact of legalising the rhino horn. So investigating the supply and the demand and how to make them equal each other to bring down the price and help conservation. And at the same time, giving people financial incentive to save the rhinos.
Right, first, normally what I do, I check the animals and see what the sizes are, the ages is, and so on. And then according to that, I go and make up my immobilizing darts. Normally within 4 to 5 minutes, the animal starts showing effects of the dart. We microchip them, take DNA samples of the horn, of the skin, some hair samples, blood samples, and then we cut off the horn.
Just darted and we're waiting for the sedative to take effect, the tranquilizer to take effect.
Right, the sedative had just started to take effect. You could see if he walks and so on, he's a bit like rubbery. Normally the tail picks up a bit as well, but he's going down now and it's now
10 minutes.
About 10 minutes, yeah. So we'll give him another minute or so and then we can slowly move closer. Yeah.
Okay, right now they're getting ready to put a blanket over the eyes.
Yes.
They're going to prepare the animal to have all the medical procedures done and to get ready for the dehorning. They'll cover his eyes. This is the young bull. He's about 2 years old. They're going to put earplugs in his ears, and then they're going to attach a rope to the back leg that acts like a brake in case the animal tries to move or get up. So far, so good, and we're going to work to get him in the best place so that they can, when they do the, when they treat him for the services, medical services, and when they treat him to get the horn removed, he'll be in a better position. They'll take all these different DNA samples to match up with the horn. That they make sure that they have the horn and the animal connected. How is this bull doing, this young bull doing?
Well, he's doing well. His color is good, his oxygenation is good, his breathing is good. He was in a bad spot just now. We moved him out of this Land Cruiser. So he's doing much better now, but we'll still reposition him so that he's in a better position to stand up and walk around.
Thanks.
Just glad we could get him out of that stuff. I think maybe this vehicle will take it back that he comes front, okay. To the front.
They've finished with the young bull. He did great. And then we've got three that they're looking at right now. They're trying to figure out which one they're going to do next. He's loading the tranquilizer gun. You can see right now it didn't go in.
That one is big.
Yeah.
First one. Yeah.
That you clipped a little bit of the ear. Can you explain why?
Okay, that's a numbering system, which we put in all the rhinos so that from a distance you can identify the rhino and say it's number, this one's number 6,
okay,
for example, and then we use that tissue for DNA as well.
Okay, so that's an identification.
Yes, identification.
And then the tar here.
That there was a little crack in this one from a long time ago, probably, which she cracked. This one. So we're just closing up the crack so that there's no infection or anything.
That one penetrated?
Yeah, that one's injected as well. You can see the plunger is right in front.
Okay.
Close to the needle.
Okay. Tracy was not hand raised. Tracy was wild. I'm not sure exactly when she got here, but she was here before Douwlina with the other male.
To prevent Rift Valley fever, anthrax, and all a few other diseases. Huh?
Can you explain why you're taking a few of the hairs?
Well, it's also for DNA. They want different samples.
4C11395 01C.
They've just cut the horn, so we're just going to mark it just to keep record of the dehorning.
And you take it somewhere to a secret, safe, secure place?
Yeah, we're going to take it to a secure place.
Very, very professional, and this is the way it should be done in any case.
Okay.
So, all horned.
Yeah, what happened in the past is that after animals were dehorned, the poachers come into the property and they don't know the animals are dehorned. So what they normally do is they follow the spoor of the animal. And immediately when they see the animal, and they see that the animal is dehorned, they shoot it, not to follow that spoor again afterwards.
Okay, right now we're looking at a pile of rhino dung. And inside this rhino dung and on top of it and crawling in and out of it are dung beetles. And these dung beetles make their life basically on this, on rhino poop. Okay, we're gonna go get the bull. He tends to wander by himself.
Most of the big bulls, they walk on their own. Okay. Only when the females come on heat, they go and mate with them.
Hij is aan.
Did it not go in?
Yes. Did it go in?
It's in the ear right now. He can use this device to read the chip.
It's going to lift him.
There it goes. Now he gets the number. And so we know exactly who, which animal this is.
Okay, 4B731. It's also DNA.
I find it interesting that's what he feels more. That the animal seems to respond more to the ear being clipped than the horn. Just like we would.
What?
Yep, push.
What?
International girl, and that's Douwlina. Well, I'm glad for this moment and glad it can be done and that she can just go on again and be free.
And she's the easiest because she's the most comfortable with people. But it's the big moment, and I have to say I'm a little feeling a little paternal or maternal, and here she comes. And I just pray that everything goes well and that she'll be able to go through this quickly and get back to living the free life she has here and be safe and well cared for. It's certainly the best alternative for her under the threat of poaching every day, but it's so unfortunate that this even has to be done. It would never have to be done if there wasn't the demand for it. Glad she's gonna be okay. Oh, Douwlina. Oh my goodness. Oh, so interesting.
Nice flat lip.
Yeah, it's a really soft flat lip.
That's a gross, yeah.
Yeah. Grateful. Good job. Better to lose a horn and even farm it than to lose their lives. I wish that we didn't have to do that. I wish there was no demand for rhino horn. Therefore, there would be no demand for poaching and no need to dehorn them. But we don't live in that world. The reality is that we live in a world where people poach and people want things they shouldn't want. And they pay the price for it. It's not safe for them to have their horn. And one day, that may change. But in the meantime, we've got to do something immediate and quick because time's running out. And these animals need for us to act. They need for us to act on their behalf. And they need for us to do what it takes to make them safe. right now they're getting ready to drill a hole into each of the horns that were removed, and they're going to microchip those horns to match the animals from which they were removed. This way they can keep track, and it will be in compliance with all the certification processes that have to be in place. And if for any reason any one of these horns made it onto the black market and it was recovered, we would know, we'd have some ability to track it and figure out maybe what happened and get it back here into the proper hands. I'm holding here the horns that have been removed from the rhino over a course of time. Each of these horns have been removed to help protect their lives from poaching. But what's amazing to me is I'm holding here what is basically no more than the equivalent of our fingernails. I might as well be holding hair from, you know, the horse's mane, or wool from lamb, or anything else. Yet this one has such an unusual and, for lack of a better word, ridiculous value attached to it. We're on our way right now to go interview the security people that patrol the fence line that protect the rhino.
Come in, Sean.
Yeah, we're walking up to meet one of the guards. His name is Jack. Hi, Jack.
Hi.
Yes, Jack, your view, what you're doing to fight, to protect these rhino from poachers.
I'm protecting the rhino against the poachers, because the thing that for future generation, so that they must be able to see them whenever we talk about the rhino or what kind of animal is it, and all these kinds of
things. Do you ever worry about animals coming in, leopard, other animals, when you're walking at night?
Yes, I also meet a lot of different animals, the leopards and all those kind of things. The birds, and that sometimes they are giving them the sign that there is something them or no that side. And then whenever they have to fly away, then I have to be careful with them or no from them.
Okay.
I don't know what it is.
So the animals help give you clues if trouble's approaching?
Yes, yes.
Do you approach the situation individually, or do you call someone to come help you check it out?
We are almost more than six on this area, so we communicate to each other with the radio.
So each individual farmer is basically the David against a Goliath. He is working out of his own pocket, out of his own resources, to protect his most valuable asset. The private farmer is the most effective resource we have right now against poaching, and apart from them, there aren't the resources to support this level of security. Okay, we're here today at Moholoholo with Brian. He is the founder and director and has been working to promote the viability, sustainability of all kinds of species in the wild. And he's been an active member in the community to fight for endangered species.
all I can say, it is very sad. And I honestly don't see the solution. There's no use treating the symptoms.
Yeah.
If you remove a million poachers now, there's a million more that will take over. We're treating symptoms. We've got to get to the people that are wanting it. And that's where I see a no-no. We're not going to get through that. Black and white. At the moment we've got two black rhinos and one white rhino.
Okay.
Yeah, so, but we get them, when they get about 19 months, we can't pass them on to a game reserve where they can go free. Yes. I rescued her actually, they called me. This baby rhino was underneath the bush. When I got there, the feet were yellow, still from birth, and torn to threads, because running around looking for mama, and belly cord was laying, totally dehydrated. So I carried my little first aid box with me, and immediately I gave her 2 liters of ringers lactate and threw it. I got it, I brought it back and I tended to myself, got it stabilized for after about a week, and then I allocated a student to be with it, as a mother, to sleep with it, eat with it, everything. You were not allowed to leave it until it was accustomed to her as a mama, that she'd call it and would come. And that's how we do all my rhinos, actually.
Yeah, she's got to have the bond. When she'd be in the wild, she'd always be around her mother. Like, they don't leave their mother until they're about 14 months old. So it's always good to have that connection with someone. Always, like, I run around with her, I play hide and seek and everything, and she quite enjoys that. What I find interesting is this is her routine, isn't it, Rachel? She finishes this and knows to come right over here, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So she does this every time.
Yeah. I love that they have a pattern and a routine. She finishes her bath, she comes for a scratch. It's a rhino spa.
It is. Hey, Dan.
Closed off there, then she, now she walks around the yard. Cute, hey?
She's so
very affectionate, much more affectionate and placid compared to the white rhino.
All rhino have 3 toes, and this is a black rhino, and you can see they have a little bit of a toenail and the 3 toes, just like the rest of her species.
And it's 12:19, so we're preparing at 12:19 for 12:30.
Yeah,
exactly. 5 liters of water. Okay. Yeah, and I did the powder
before. Okay, so they have before. Okay. Nice and warm. Yeah. Thank you, Coca-Cola. When you're giving him the bottle, you have to hold it on, because he can suck it off.
Will he sleep through the night?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then good boy.
Good boy.
Good boy.
Good boy.
Yum, yum, yum.
Good boy. It's all done. Good boy. I know it's no more, honey. No more.
Well, he's about 7 months old now, so.
And he's still not sure about his environment. Is that what he's trying to get used to?
Yeah,
his environment?
He's trying to get used to me and the environment.
Yes, yeah, okay. It's 2 days today since we dehorned all the rhino, and they're doing fabulously. Not only are they completely back to their normal routine, but when we drove up in the vehicle, Douwlina and the others came right up to us, and had the dog not barked at them, they probably would still be close to us at the vehicle. They are living the way they always live. They are not afraid to come up to us. They have not had any physical or psychological damage from this process. They're back right out where they used to be. What would you be able to do with the resources and the revenue that would be generated from?
Grace, if we work on 50% of the black market value, or even less than 50%, And if we can sell this legally, we can buy 5 to 6 more female rhino to breed with.
There are only 35,000 rhino on the planet. The majority of them are in South Africa, mostly white rhino. And they're the ones that are being slaughtered at 2 a day.
At the moment, nobody wants to farm with rhino. Everybody wants to sell.
So we need to do something to create incentives for people to keep rhino on their property, to repopulate the rhino, as well as diminish, if not eliminate, all the desire for poaching.
As our caretakers, we look to you for a way out. It's not by choice that we share our Eden. The only one with choice is you. Do we have time to one day meet your descendants? Or will you only tell them about us?